my emotions. But that song just couldn't help it.
You got a package for me.
That's why I say to you, you just don't know what God has done for somebody. Just need to keep our mouths shut. And just pray and thank God that that person would want to express what they feel about Jesus. I know what he's brought me from. I know what he's brought me through. Every day I wake up now and I thank him that I'm still alive.
To talk, he think I'm talking to him.
But I want you to take a look with me. Let's go to Genesis chapter 3. And I want you to see how the devil wants to put doubt in our hearts and our minds about God. You know the story. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field, which the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die. For God knows that in that day, in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Doubt. This is the object which Satan seeks to accomplish. There is nothing that he desires more than to destroy our confidence in God and in his word. Satan stands at the head of the great army of doubters. He works to the utmost of his power to beguile souls into his ranks. It is becoming fashionable to doubt. There is a large class by whom the word of God is looked upon with distrust for the same reason as was its author. Because it reproves and it condemns sin. Those who are unwilling to obey its requirements endeavor to overthrow its authority. They read the Bible or listen to its teachings as presented from the sacred desk merely to find fault with the scripture or with the sermon. Others adopt skeptical principles because of pride and indolence. Doubt will also be found in such persons who actuate their self-confidence and pride. Doubt is brought about when we want so much for something for us when God never said it was yours. Many delight in finding something in the scriptures to puzzle the minds of others. Some at first criticize and reason on the wrong side from the mere love of controversy. Isn't it amazing? But some folk just love controversy. They just can't see things going well. They just gotta start some stuff. Some mess. And for some odd reason, they just don't like you. You ain't done nothing to them. But they just don't like you. I don't know what it is, but I don't like them. Those are the ones that just want to keep stuff going. about Galatians and through the Sabbath school what it is and all about, but we don't like looking in the mirror at ourselves. That's what the law is. It's a mirror. Let us see that we ain't all that we claim we are. Requires it kept when you take a moment and look in the mirror and you're trying to smooth out your face, you still want to find some defects. Those defects have nothing to do with your character. Because your character must reflect beyond the defects. Satan is well aware that the weakest soul who abides in Christ is more than a match for the darkness of this world. The weakest soul. Those who doubt God's promises and distrust the assurance of his grace are dishonoring him. And their influence, instead of drawing others to Christ, tends to repel people from him. Our walk should be so close to God that people just can't not want to be around you. They can't help but being around you. I don't know what it is, but I just gotta go and talk. What is it about her? What is it about him that seems to propel me to come and just sit and just listen? Or better yet, share my story. Some folk don't know how to share their story, because they are so untrusting of other people. You know what I'm talking about. You just can't tell your story to everybody. Some folk you tell it to, and it'll be all on the north side and the south side of Philadelphia before you get back home. So you say to yourself, God, you tell me to trust people, but how can I trust folk when I talk to one person that myself is already out there? So we kind of reserve ourselves and we keep ourselves in a place where we try our best to make sure that when I talk to someone, I know that I have confidence in someone. That they're going to keep their mouth shut. And I have confidence that it's going to the grave with them. You know. So I ain't going to talk to nobody but the pastor. Because if the pastor got to keep my stuff, he can't do anything. Because some of us already know. We done come from somewhere where it says, go to confessional. And you go in there and, Father, I have sinned. And he says, go and do about 20 Hail Marys. You know, and then one to the Father. But I'm going to tell you to pray to God before you come to me. Because the first person you need to talk to is Jesus. And then I guarantee you, Jesus will direct you to the right person to talk to. You ever wonder why sometimes you just got to go and talk to this one individual? Maybe it's because God has empowered you to talk to that one individual. And that individual is going to keep your stuff. The devil just wants you to keep doubting God. Just like he put doubt in Eve, he wants to keep putting doubt in us. Is God really real? Does he really? Did he really live? You got folk out there thinking, did he really live? You say, is he really in heaven? I don't know about you, but I got enough evidence in my life to know that Jesus came, lived, died, and has rose again. Had Eve refrained from entering into an argument with the tempter, she would have been saved. That's what we do sometimes. We think we can talk to the devil. We can tell the devil what to do. I'm here to tell you, you gotta run as far away as you can. Amen. Stay as far from him as you can. Hold fast to the precious hands of Jesus. And when the devil is on you, you turn around and look at him like you said, Jesus, tell him, get thee behind me, Satan. Start
Put these promises of God in your heart. I fear not, be not dismayed, for I am with you. I've got to hold on to it. My Bible says very clearly, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. And even when I'm in the valley of the shadow of death, I shouldn't fear no evil. For God is with me. Don't be having me doubt, Jesus. I'm sorry. I've got had too much experience. I've had too many things to happen that I'm still here today. But you know how it is. We just like Peter. In our confidence, we'll tell Jesus, I'll go to the grave with you, Jesus. Jesus looked at Peter and said, before the morning, before the rooster crowed, you will deny me three times. Peter felt really bad about that. Come on, Jesus, you know, man. Me and you. Me and you like this. You know I ain't gonna. If you go, I'm going. But Peter had to learn. Peter had to learn that his self-confidence,
amen,
his confidence is not in him.
Amen.
But confidence in Jesus.
Amen.
Surely, God is always there. Unless you are in danger. I take that back.
Yeah.
When you're in danger, God is even there even more.
Amen.
When you're struggling, God is there even more.
Yes.
When Peter looked at Jesus, the Savior saw in him a self-love and an assurance that would ever bear upon him and his love for God. As much as we say we love Jesus, there's, oh my goodness, sin is so powerful. Sin is so powerful that even in our love for God, there's some element within us that will still fight God.
That's right.
Help. Oh, y'all quiet now. My steps to spiritual revival is to confront me.
Yes.
Is to examine me.
Yes.
And I can't talk to you until God talks to me.
Right.
And when he examines me and says that there is even specks in me, I know that there are specks in you.
Yes.
Even when I'm trying my best, my wife even says, you're going to have to pull it together. You're going to have to but watch your little tongue. And I catch myself sometimes as I'm riding by myself. I say, I'm going to get me. Earl.
That's right. Keep it real.
Earl.
Earl,
that's
right.
You gotta wash that out. You can't use those terminologies anymore.
Right.
Yes, you know how to use them because you use them while you hanging out in the hood, while you with your boys, while you on the court, while you on the football field, while you on the basketball field, while you was all over the place. You know how to use them. You heard them in your house. So that's nothing from you. But Earl, God is trying to change you. And if he's changing you, then you can't go falling back into the same old
stuff.
I believe the psalm says, I've come too far that I can't turn back now. I'm heading in a different direction. But Satan is constantly there. Constantly trying to, come on, go ahead and say the word. But I gotta make sure that my heart that I say is right. Gotta act right. I believe we said. in Sabbath school. Action is what it is. So that means when the fools come my way, and when stuff happens, I gotta say, jeez, oh my goodness, what was wrong with them? God, you gotta help them. And thank you, Lord, that I wasn't caught up in and got hurt. I cannot convert back. Because God has said, until you are converted, how can you bless the lambs that I've put in your care? Until you are where you need to be. See, God has to take us to another place. And just like Jesus looked at Peter with compassion, he looks at you and me. When we cannot save ourselves from our trials, God is standing there. And he demonstrates his confidence in us by him saying the one most precious word that we should read and hear all day. It is finished.
Disciples heard him say, after I am risen again, I will go before you in Galilee. I want to say to you, God has said that to you and me. Now that I've risen, I've already gone before you. And I'm just waiting for you to come to be with me. Surely.